Okay, so you never heard me play, so that's why you applause. Oh, nice. I'm Lucky Rihart from the Intel Open Source Technology Center. And this talk is about Cloud Dbus, aka Dbus for the cloud, which is a Dbus proxies for JavaScript. So first, I'm going to discuss why do we want at all to do Dbus proxies for JavaScript and how we do it. Then I go through the JavaScript API on how you can use Dbus proxy directly in JavaScript in a simple example. And then I show the server side of the stuff, so how you run the Python server. Security and this kind of thing. Why? There are several reasons. The main is to implement HTML5 APIs on different platforms, so I'll go through it. So there are pros and cons on this thing. The nice thing is that almost every server, every low-level services in Linux has a Dbus interface. If you want to expose these interfaces to JavaScript, you'd have to write a native plugin or to write a CVE script. So that would be one piece of server code per Dbus interface. While here, you only do it once. The cons is that, well, it only works on Linux, on the server side. And you obviously need to be able to restrict the Dbus access because you don't want to give your keyring access to the internet, for instance. Where can you use this kind of thing? So if you want to develop a network device that exports part of its services on the network, or if you want to implement an HTML5 API on a given platform. So let's go through some existing Dbus services that are pretty useful and that you might want to use in a web app. So there's Bluesy, which is Bluetooth, so it does object exchanges and networking. Tracker, so if you like SparkQL you want to do web indexing, that thing to do. Rigel for media services, Ophono for telephony, also Nerd, so if you want to do NFC server. And then on the HTML5 side, there are several APIs that are more or less connected to this thing, like the W3C, the device application group. They are starting to specify messaging, telephony, media capture, but it's not frozen yet. You have Cordova, aka PhoneGap, which does the same kind of thing for mobile. And Tizen, which is a Linux OS with HTML5 API. So right now it's all moving. It's not frozen yet. So you don't really want to work on an API if you have to change it later. Hence, do it all on Dbus and JavaScript. So how do we do it? So that's a global picture. We have a Python server that acts as a middleman between the Dbus services and the web app. So it uses Autobahn, which is a Python framework that does RPC, and also signal handling, which is built on Python Twisted itself. And we use the Python Dbus library on the Dbus end, and the Python JSON library to exchange the JSON messages through WebSockets. Okay, so now we'll go through the Dbus proxy API. So what's a Dbus proxy? So in case you haven't used Dbus at all, so a proxy is a reference to an object on the server. It has a properties that can be of simple type or complex, like dictionaries, array, and so on. It implements interface with method, and you can register a callback on a proxy to respond on a Dbus signal. An example, so the screensaver GNOME interface. So here, there's three methods and one signal. So the getActive method returns a boolean that says if the screen is locked or not. The setActive method locks the screen or unlocks it. And the showMessage method displays the message on the screen while the screen is locked. And then there's a reActiveChange signal that is triggered every time the screen is locked or unlocked. And it sends a boolean that says if the screen is locked or unlocked. So it's all straightforward. How would you program this in Python with Python proxies? So here it's really straightforward. You get a handle on the session bus. You get the screensaver root object and the screensaver interface on this object. And then you just call the method. So here, this code would lock the screen, display a message that says, hello, Python Dbus is cool, sleep for 3 seconds, and unlock the screen. So now, if you would like to do the same thing in JavaScript, first, the big difference would be that JavaScript is asynchronous here. So instead of calling method foo with parameters x, y, and getting a result, you'd call method foo, pass a couple of handler function, so one to get a result and one in case of error. And in the reply handler, you get the result. So here, instead of of.foo xy, you do of.foo xy reply and error. So it's same thing, but asynchronous. So now, if I want to do the same thing in Python that locks the screen, display a message, and unlocks it, with Cloud Dbus, so first I would connect to the server. So here it's on the localhost. I have this callback when I'm connected, or I do pretty much the same thing as in Python. So I get the session bus. I get a proxy on the screensaver object. And here I pass a callback that's called when the proxy is introspected. So the introspect function reads the XML data and adds the method to the object. So here I can lock the screen just like in Python, show a message. Instead of sleeping, so in a JavaScript, I set a timer for 3 seconds, and after 3 seconds, I display the lock state, and unlock it. And I'm courageous, I can try it. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, it's unlocked. And the log message is here. So you see, in this case, I use the object. I have introspected the object in an asynchronous callback. I can also use it directly in a lower level API. So here, same thing. I get the proxy, but I don't pass a callback for introspection. And instead of locking it by doing proxy.setActive, I have a more cumbersome method. I call the method, giving the interface, the method name, and the argument. And of course, I can add a callback after that if I want a result. I also connect to the log signal. And so when I get the signal, so I log the state change, I disconnect, and I unlock it. So here it's barely gonna blink, not even, okay? So it say, okay, it's changed. I know it's unlocked. So that's this log here and this log. 11. Uh-huh. Okay, so just a quick glance on the server side. So CloudEBus on the server side is a Python server. You can run it without a security enable in open door mode. So here, everybody can access to Anybus, which is good for demo, but you don't really want to do this in real life. Or you can add credentials and a whitelist. So I'll add an example here. So on the server side, I put a whitelist. I say client can only access, so here, Nautilus and Screensaver. The only user I know are CloudEBus, user 1, user 2, so it's user and password. And on the client side, the application has a manifest pretty much like a Chrome manifest with user, version, password, and permissions that it wants to access. So the handshake is handled by Autobahn, which encrypts the password through the network, so they don't go unencrypted. And that's about it. So next, I'd have to export the services, port it on Node.js, so that's done already, and do a bunch of stuff. I take patches, so if you want to participate, you're welcome. Thanks.
Why to have choose Dbus and not something like Zero C ICE? ICE is something with a lot of success in communication world.
Well, actually, I had to write a web interface for several Dbus services. So NFC, telephony, DLNA and stuff. And at the end of the day, instead of writing one NP API plugin per component, I found it was much more easier to just take the whole debug thing and pull it to JavaScript. So I didn't have the use for other servers, so I just did it because the server I wanted to expose to JavaScript were already using Dbus.
Thank you.